Hi everyone, welcome back to my channel. This is the fourth video I'm going to post it on the topic of AP joining issues troubleshooting. So I already posted three videos in my channel and this is the fourth one, and this one is pending for long, and I'm just trying to finish this entire topics in with this video. So we already talked about cable related issues, how to troubleshoot cable related issues on AP joining. Then we talked about PoE related steps related to AP joining. It's not AP joining basically without having PoE, proper PoE requirement is not met, then your APs will not be joining. So that is some of the other things we talked about before. Then we talked about IP addressing for AP. Then we talked about layer 3 connectivity, how to troubleshoot on layer 3 connectivity. Then the major topic we also covered the CAPAP related troubleshooting. What are the things you had to check in the background, and how to troubleshoot each one of them? Basically the CAPAP discovery process. So this was the last one we did it. So it's a continuation from here, and next topic it's WLC code. So when we talk about AP joining issues, most of the time we will miss the compatibility metrics on the hardware support on the code we are going to run it on WLC. So this is one of the major thing, because all the hardwares or all the APs are not supported on all the releases coming from Cisco. So you have to make sure your WLC code is compatible with the AP model that you are going to use. For an example, the latest code like 8.5 and all, it will not support 1130, 1240 APs in the background. So you go to the page that shows the release note of this particular code, and you go for the supported APs and non-supported APs to get that list. You can get it from the release note of that particular code. So that is some of the thing, one of the thing you have to check. And the next one is the AP image bundle in 5508. So in case of latest codes like 8.5 or something, all the AP codes are not coming with the original AES file for you. Basically, they are splitting the code into two. So you have to be sure that you are adding that particular AP code bundle with the 5508 WLC, because your code is getting split into two. So if you want to support the legacy APs with 5508, you have to make sure you are actually loading that AP bundle in the background. So please make sure that you are actually using this one for supporting the legacy mode APs. Let's move into the seventh point, that is the licensing. So most of the time we will think that, okay, factory default device will come with proper licenses for AP. So actually you will have evaluation licenses for 90 days or something, but some of the time you will see that, okay, that license is available, but it's not activated. So you make sure you have the license activated and you are able to accept the AP. So just make sure you are having the sufficient AP licenses on the WLC so that APs will be able to join on that. Then we already covered this one, like active state. So even if you have legacy WLCs or something like that, you have multiple licensing models. Basically, some of the licenses are directly mapped to your serial number, some of the licenses are mapped to your Cisco One licensing model, then there are smart licensing option available. So 5508 can support serial number mapped with that license. Also, it can support the smart licensing kind of Cisco One license. So you make sure the right licensing model is in use, and you have the sufficient licenses to accept the AP. And another thing is your N plus one scenario. So sometimes you will be using N plus one scenario, but that doesn't mean that you have to, you can have only licenses on one device. So if you are doing a fallback on the other WLC, from one WLC to another WLC, make sure you have the sufficient licenses added on that HA N plus one WLC, so that these APs are able to move without fail. So this is one of the thing. Sometimes we will order licenses only on one controller, and maybe we will not update that on the other one. Maybe we'll be having n plus one scenario for multiple sites getting added into one site. So the n plus one, the one WLC that acting as a standby or the secondary controller, that should have enough licenses. For an example, if you have 100 licenses on one side, 100 licenses on other side, but both are falling back to one redundant or secondary WLC, you have to have 200 licenses on the other one. Otherwise, in a case of failure on two sides, you will end up in having only a 100 AP support on the other side. So just make sure that you have sufficient licenses available on the secondary WLC in n plus one scenario. Then evaluation license, sometimes we will miss the dates on that evaluation, so please keep an eye on the evaluation licenses before you your evaluation license is expired. You have to just renew the license, or you have to get the permanent license for that. So whatever APs are connected to the WLC, that may continue serving your clients, because there is no join process triggered when your AP is already on connected state. So maybe you will not realize that, okay, AP is disconnected and it's not coming back. So it can be one AP, it can be two AP, but you keep an eye on your evaluation license, so that you will get all of your APs on the WLC side. So there is AP licensing on the WLC side. Now let's talk about the next point, that is a certificate that is coming along with the AP. So you have three different type of certificate available with the AP. One is like manufacturer already put a certificate in build, and next one is LSE, locally signed certificate, then you have a self-signed certificate. So we have three type of certificates supported with the WLC AP joining process. Manufacturing installed certificate is the common certificate used by most of us, and all the latest APs coming from Cisco side will have that particular certificate installed on it. So only thing we have to make sure is this particular manufacturing installed certificate is valid as per the expiry date. Other than that, we don't have any issues. And another thing, we have to make sure that the authentication using manufacturer installed certificate is enabled on your AP policy, so authorization policy. So if you have these two things, expiry date is still valid, and your MIC is enabled on your WLC, you will be getting your APs without having any issues. So another problem in this one, the expiry date is completely depends on when they manufactured that particular hardware. So most of the time that keep varying based on the time they install that certificate. So there are some access points that is still in your production and it's very old. Maybe your certificate is going to be expired. So if you have very legacy access points still functioning on your network, be careful with this particular certificate expiry, so that you will not face any issues, because before your certificate got expired, you have to make sure either you are moving into different certificate model, or you are actually replacing those hardwares. Like it's not lifetime certificate, it will be like 10 years of validity or something. So be careful with that if you have very old APs in your network. Then LSE, that's a certificate, is a locally signed certificate. Again, the expiry date will come into picture, and your LIC, the LSE is enabled on your site for the WLC side. Then cert server certificate is installed based on your certificate authority in your network. So it's this one is a typo. You have to make sure LSE certificate is accepted by the WLC. Sorry for that. Be careful. Be careful when you are having local signed certificate and you are enabling only the MIC-based certificate authentication. So if you are planning to use LSE, please make sure your LSE certificate authentication is enabled for AP policies. Then SSC certificate, it's the same. Your expiry date has to be checked. So I'm recalling each and every item repeatedly on each scenario because this is something you can use when you are troubleshooting your AP joining issue. So this particular flow chart or this Mind Master tree is available in my LinkedIn profile. You will be able to get this one. So by using this, you will be able to find which one you are facing, which issue you are facing, and you can correlate with the actual scenario. Then these are the three different type of certificate. Most of the issues will be common, but just you have three different type of certificate and you have to play with that. Next one is regulatory domain. So most of the time we will not have this issue because you are ordering your hardware in your local country. So you will be ordering, you will be placing your request in the local country and you will be getting the delivery from the local country. So in that scenario, you are not going to face any issues on the regulatory domain because your WLC and AP will have the same configuration and your country code will be enabled on based on that. But in case if you are getting a specific country or if you are planning to use some other regulatory domain on your WLC, you make sure that particular country code is enabled. So you can find this metrics between the connection between the country code and regulatory domain. So you can check this one in the Cisco site. Cisco site is provides one link for check this compatibility metrics on AP and country code based on the country code. So you make sure you are having the right country code selected on the controller to accept that particular regulatory domain. So all these APs are coming with the regulatory domain hard-coded on it. So you will not be able to change that until you are having a universal AP. So if you have a universal AP based on AP provisioning tool and all, you will be able to change your country code. Otherwise, most of the APs are coming with regulatory domain hard-coded onto AP. So you make sure you are selecting the right country code on your WLC so that you will be able to accept that particular AP on the WLC. Otherwise, APs will be coming and trying to join with the WLC, but WLC will reject them. So this is applicable for the APs coming from one location. So for an example, you have an N plus scenario, N plus one scenario, or some other HA related configuration. So that allows these APs to go and join on some other, basically the fallback, AP fallback from one WLC to another WLC, but that WLC is sitting on some other location. It can be like remote sites like Flex Connect APs coming from one country and joining on other WLC as a fallback mechanism. So in this kind of scenario, you have to make sure the secondary controller who is supporting this extra country is having that country selected on your WLC. So this is how it works in background. So always make sure you are meeting the regulatory domain compatibility metrics and you are able to use the AP. And next one, it's not something common for everyone, but this is the scenario we seen when we are placing the access points outside or inside some cold storage or something like that. So we are talking about those APs designed supposed to be work inside a building or something like that, and you are placing that outside outside the building. So in some places, our temperature will not be the it will not be something that's supported by access point. So you can go through the data sheet and you can find the variables on this particular temperature. What is the minimum and what is the maximum temperature it can, operational temperature we are talking about. So sometimes if you are placing APs outside, you make sure your APs are placed in a shade or in a proper box so that it can work inside that temperature range. If you are placing it outside somewhere in the Middle East or something with higher temperature outside, then maybe these APs will not be able to function. And there are other conditions like you are putting these access points in a cold storage or something that is also will have some issues. So just find out the the temperature that AP can operate, and based on that you place the AP. Otherwise, it will show an error based on that. Not only temperature, there are other criteria on the environmental side. So make sure each of them are taken care when you are placing the AP outside or inside some cold storage. So you can find this information from your data sheet of that particular AP, and based on that use the right case for the cases, outdoor cases, or you place the access points based on the like limitation on that temperature side. Then so some of the areas we seen that APs are placed, it was working fine, and sometimes it will fail, and when we do the investigation we'll find that this one is failed because of the over temperature on that area. So be aware of it. It's not a common scenario, but I just thought of covering it here. Let's move to the next one. Next one is the mesh APs. So mesh APs, it's not, again, outdoor mesh is not a common solution used by everyone. So wherever you are having mesh APs, the discovery mechanism is almost same. So you have to make sure the above mentioned discovery mechanism is already taken care for mesh APs. And next one is the MAC address filter. So if you have MAC filtering enabled for mesh APs, you make sure this MAC filtering list is containing your AP MAC, so that mesh APs will be able to join on that. Then authorization policies, if you are using authorization policies, you make sure this AP entry is added into your AP authorization policies, and it's able to join on that. Then next one, setting the mesh AP role. So based on the role, the action will be taken in the background. So you should be putting the right role for the mesh IPs on the WLC side. Then if you are using radius authentication for APs, we covered this radius authentication and all on top, but just make sure for mesh APs you are covering that. Then sometimes you'll have PSK keys created for maps. So in that scenario, make sure your maps are having right pre-shared key shared with that, and there is no issues with that. Then make sure default PSK option is enabled in case if you are using mesh AP provisioning. So this is one of the feature available on WLC to accept default PSK. So make sure default PSK is enabled for factory default APs. It will be helpful for you to get those APs. Also make sure RF related issues are taken care. So when you have mesh APs placed, you should be doing the right RF designing. Otherwise, maybe it will not be able to communicate each other, and this mesh will have a disconnect in between. So make sure this RF design is taken care when you are creating this design itself. So RF design is the key on mesh network. So be careful when you are creating that particular design. So this is the final and last video going to be talking about AP joining issues. So hope this one will help you in troubleshooting your AP joining issues. As I said earlier, you can find this flow in my LinkedIn page. So this is my LinkedIn link for that. Then you have a shorter link that directly point to the article I posted in the LinkedIn. So you can follow this link for that article. Thank you for watching.